نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بل قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه وما تأخر، ومن قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه، ومن قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. متفق عليه. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه. There are three things mentioned in this hadith which is quoted in Bukhari and Muslim عليهم الرحمة. That Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام gave three different aspects of Ramadan al-Mubarak, and on each one of them Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام has conditioned the forgiveness of the abd and the servant and the worship of Allah. The first is that person who fasts Ramadan with two qualities: iman, in a state of faith and state of belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there are many people who fast which are not, they are not Muslims, but they fast. They stay away from meat. Some others have different forms of fast. But they earn nothing from their fast but hunger, because they miss that element of iman, that special ingredient which gives a one to all the zeros. If you can have a million zeros with nothing in front of it, means nothing. But if you have one in front of that six zeros, mashallah, we know what that means. So that one is that belief in kalima, in iman. So that's the first quality, ihtisaba, and hoping for reward on the promises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you have these two qualities, your past sins will be forgiven. Again, Nabi alayhi sallam mentions, if you stand in the month of Ramadan in salah, your past sins will be forgiven. And if you stand on Laylatul Qadr, your past sins will be forgiven. Muhaddithin mentioned on the commentary of this hadith that Qiyam-i Ramadan actually means Taraweeh, salah, and A'mal of Ramadan. Anything which is connected to Ramadan from ibadat. And they explain, for example, if someone is in Umrah, then Qiyam Ramadan there will mean to make Umrah, to make Tawaf, to do as many Tawafs as possible, etc. Then Qiyam Laylatul Qadr is that person who makes an effort to find Laylatul Qadr, whether he knows it or he doesn't know it. Muhaddithin mentioned, whether he knows it or he doesn't know it, which night was Laylatul Qadr, but he made effort on every odd night, his past sins will be forgiven. And the third aspect of غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ, all his past sins are forgiven. Imam Nawawi alayhi rahmah, the great muhaddith, says that all the aspects of mukaffirat, you know, those things which get our sins forgiven. For example, Jum'ah to Jum'ah, Salah to Salah, Ramadan to Ramadan. These things are called mukaffirat al-dhunub, those things which expiate and wash away sins. So he said, when it comes to these things, remember two aspects: all minor sins are forgiven immediately through these actions, and the major sins are yukhaffaf, are made lighter. The seriousness of the major sins which have been done become lighter in a person's mizan as sayyi'at. They become lighter. So there is double fold benefit from this. In fact, there is threefold benefit. And he says that person who has no sins in his record, that amal and that action becomes a means of his hasanat and his darajat in Jannah, which go higher and higher. So subhanallah, brothers and sisters in Islam, we see that Ramadan encapsulates the actual essence of forgiveness from Allah Rabbul Izzah. In it there is so many different aspects, which is given a promise by Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. Allah give us the ability to do it with through spirit and through sincerity and ikhlas. Inshallah, tonight we will be beginning Suratul Araf, and inshallah we'll be completing Suratul Araf. So a complete surah will be recited tonight inshallah, which will start from half of Juz 8 to about the three quarter of Juz 9 inshallah. Section of the Quran Kareem starts off with the incident of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, which we are very well aware of. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him, and Allah says, usjudu li Adam fasajadu illa iblis, Allah says, prostrate to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the command of Allah. What was Iblis reply? Ana khayrun min. I am better than him. We understand from this, brothers and sisters, that the seed of all sin is that I am better. I am better, I know more. I am more wealthy, I am more powerful, I am more knowledgeable, I am more smarter. When a person sees himself better than others, this is the seed of all sin, and it is the inception of the downfall of a person. Just as it happened with Shaitan La'in, that when he saw himself, he was mashallah in the ibadah of Allah, with the company of the angels in Jannah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a maqam, what a stage he had. But that stage deceived him, and he forgot his haqiqat, and he forgot his reality. And what was his reality? What is our reality? We are mere servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are mere ibad and abd. When the command of Allah comes and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes, everything else must be put aside. Allah's command must come first. And that's what he forgot. And if we forget the same, Allah protect one and all. That is the beginning and the inception of our downfall. Allahu Akbar. You know, sometimes somebody might be, you know, an alcoholic, and we look down upon him for that. But what do we know? There's one amal maybe in his life he has done. One thing. He did it with such khulus and such muhabba for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that on that one amal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already registered him from the people of Jannah, and we are still unsure and not guaranteed about our safety on the day of Qiyamah. So at the end of the day, it's not about what we do, but it's the rahm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. What was Adam alayhi salatu salam's attitude and request after this incident, when he was then misled by Shaitan because of Shaitan's jealousy? There's a lot of lessons from this incident of Shaitan and Adam alayhi salatu salam. Shaitan then misled Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salatu salam because of jealousy. What was the attitude? What was the request from the two of them? Adam alayhi salatu salam, Ibn Kathir has a riwayah here, which he mentions that Adam alayhi salatu salam then asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what happens now? What will I do, or what will happen if I make tawbah and istighfar? Allah says, I will forgive you and I will enter you into Jannah. So that was his attitude of regret and his request for forgiveness. What was Shaitan's attitude? His attitude was of pride. And what was his request? Andirni ila yawmi yub'athun. His request wasn't forgiveness. His request was, oh Allah, give me chance till the day of Qiyamah. I'm going to lead everyone astray. لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. I will wait for them. He mentions, you will listen to the words of the Quran, tonight he recited, لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ. I will sit in ambush, waiting for them, to make them do the wrong thing and say the wrong thing, to take them away. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the aspect of يَا بَنِي آدَمْ خُدُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدِ. The etiquettes, protocol of masajid. How should you dress and how you should come to the masjid? Beautify yourself. Come in dress appropriately to the masjid. Meaning your aura should be covered. You should not come in clothes which you would not want anyone to see you outside with. The clothes you won't go for interview with, the clothes you won't go visit your friends and family with, don't come with that clothes to the masjid. Your pajamas, for example, clothes which are torn, tattered. You won't want to be seen outside like that. So how do you dare and how do I dare come in front of Allah Rabbul Izzah like that? In fact, it is mustahab that a person applies itr before he comes for Allah's pleasure, that I am coming to stand in the court of Allah and I must understand that maqam and that stage and that platform on which I am standing. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about aspects. وَلِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ أَجَلٍ. Everything is appointed on a fixed time. لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ أَجَلٍ. Every nation, every person has an appointed time. After that time, time is expired. Not like sell by date, you know. Expiry date, we still have the item. When it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the expiry date comes, that's it, finish. So we understand from that maut, al-mautu babun kullun dakhiluhu. That death is a door, everyone is going to enter that door. Today, tomorrow, after 1 year, after 10 years, but everyone, we are on a journey and we are heading. We are moving through the house of dunya and we will come to the door which will lead us to the akhirah. So So this is something that we need to prepare for. And in fact, for a mu'min, it is tuhfa. Al-mawtu tuhfatul mu'min. That maut is a gift for a believer. Why? All the salah I'm making, all the ibadah I'm making, all the adhkar I'm doing, all the things I'm trying to make Allah happy with. Allah has promised me things on it. Allah has promised me Jannah. Allah has promised me pleasures in Jannah. Allah has promised me happiness. How can I get it? I will have to go through death to get all those ni'am and all those pleasures. So it is actually something for me to hope for. And if I'm not hoping for it, then there's something wrong with my action. My actions are not right. That's why I don't want to go through that. Because I know what is waiting for me on the other side. May Allah forgive us for our mistakes, weaknesses, and give us tawfiq to correct our amal. Then one aspect is brought about the people of Jannah. Allah says, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهِمُ الْأَنْهَارُ وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي هَدَانَا. When the people of Jannah and Jahannam will be put into their places, there is a riwayah here by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which says, كُلُّ أَهْلُ الْجَنَّةِ كَانَ كُلُّ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ يَرَى مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ النَّارِ فَيَقُولُ. That every person of Jannah will see his abode which was destined for him in Jahannam if he had led a wrong life. And in what he will say, لَوْلَا أَنَّ اللَّهَ هَدَانِي فَيَكُونُ لَهُ شُكْرًا. That if Allah did not guide me to do what I was doing in my life, that would have been my place. And he would be filled with gratitude and appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So hidayah, Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana lihada wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. This we are making salah, this we are fasting, this Quran we are listening to, the Quran we are reading. Where is it from, brothers? Where is it? It is from the hidayat and the guidance Allah is giving us. So we should realize that and we should thank Allah for that. And the people of Jahannam will see their place in Jannah, that if they had led a good life, they would have been in that place. And they would say, لَوْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ هَدَانِي فَيَكُونُ لَهُ حَسْرًا. That if only Allah had guided me, then I would have been in that place. So it's all based on hidayah, the اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ, which we spoke about on the first day. The most important element in a person's life, that guidance. You know, as we know, we, mashallah, have GPS nowadays, you know. If you don't know where you're going, Allahu Akbar, you waste time, you waste petrol, your tension goes up, and drive around in circles. And then if you have that, mashallah, you just type it in and straight from point A to point B. That is that hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person has focus, he knows where is he going, he knows what he has to do, and he knows what is to be done, and he does it. That is guidance from Allah, which we should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. Allah grant us tawfiq. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.